If I run for president, Brown vowed, I will be the most pro-union candidate in this race bar none. Brown, 66, has been pursuing, and winning, elected office his entire adult life. Shortly before graduating from Yale in 1974, he was recruited to run for Ohio State House and won, taking office at the age of 23. Since then he has served as Ohio Secretary of State and as a seven-term congressman representing Cleveland's southwest suburbs. He was re-elected to a third term in the Senate in 2018. Now Brown is eyeing a loftier post. Last November, 2 years after Donald Trump routed Hillary Clinton in Ohio by 8 percentage points, Brown won his race by 7 even as the rest of Ohio's Democratic slate went down to defeat. Taking note of the senator's singular success in an increasingly conservative state as one of the Senate's most liberal members, no less pundits suddenly began to tout him as an underrated 2020 presidential prospect. That, in turn, inspired Brown and his wife, the Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist Connie Schultz, to start considering, for what they say was the first time, whether those pundits might actually have a point. Hence the trip to Nevada, the next-to-last stop on a listening tour designed to introduce Brown to voters in the first 4 primary states and to help him decide, one way or the other, on a run, which he says he intends to do by end of March. Hence to his Q&A with the culinary workers, and the pro-union promise he made them. If Brown does, in fact, challenge Trump, he will do it in a very specific and stubbornly old-fashioned way. There aren't enough people who call themselves labor Democrats, Brown told me in Las Vegas. There's aren't enough Democrats who look at labor as the central organizing principle of our party. Without a strong labor movement, you end up losing on the big issues of the day. In other words, Brown would campaign nationally just like he's always campaigned in Ohio, as a labor Democrat himself. The goal, he says, would be to portray the president as a phony populist who won the White House by duping workers in Ohio, Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, and to pitch himself to those same voters as the real deal. I would bring into the White House the presidents and CEOs of the biggest banks, in the biggest high-rise buildings, and I would say, I don't want to embarrass anybody, but what are you paying your contractors? Brown told the crowd as he stood in front of signs reading, "One job should be enough. Not just your employees. What are you paying your food service workers? What are you paying your custodians? What are you paying your security guards? Don't you think you could pay all of them $15 an hour too?" Brown's message seemed to resonate. Afterward, I buttonholed D. Taylor, who led Local 226 from 1990 to 2002 and now serves as president of its parent union, Unite Here. "If we're just part of the checklist, Democrats will lose workers again," Taylor told me. But Senator Brown is different. He's actually embracing labor. His track record is there. He understands bread and butter issues. It's like workers have become a sideshow. "No, we're it. Democrats have lost their way on that. Senator Brown hasn't. There's little doubt Democrats have drifted away from labor over the last several decades. The question that could define Brown's candidacy and determine his fate is whether the party, and the country, are starting to drift back. Once upon a time, a Democrat wouldn't have needed to describe himself as pro-union. The terms were basically synonymous. 2 years into his presidency, Franklin D. Roosevelt said it was a fundamental individual right of a worker to associate himself with other workers and to bargain collectively with his employer. The Democratic Party represents the people, Harry Truman added in 1948. It is pledged to work for labor. In the 1970s, however, something changed. After Vice President Hubert Humphrey lost to Republican Richard Nixon in 1968, Democrats formed the Commission on Party Structure and Delegate Selection. Its goal was to heal and restructure the party, and restructure the party it did, slashing the influence of unions under the guidance of strategist Fred Dutton. Dutton sought to eject from the Democratic Party the white working class, which he saw as a major redoubt of traditional Americanism and of the anti-Negro, anti-youth vote, the Atlantic's Matt Stoller has written. The future, he argued, lay in a coalition of African Americans, feminists, and affluent, young, college-educated whites. Dutton's realignment succeeded. At the time, it felt like a natural evolution. The social safety net had been built. The unions had grown strong. The Great Depression was a distant memory. And so while the blue-collar group was in the forefront in the 1930s, Dutton wrote, now it is the white-collar sector taking the lead. Meanwhile, as Dutton and co. were weakening labor's sway over the Democratic Party, other forces, globalization, Reagan Republicans, the rise of shareholder value were undermining its foothold in the workplace. As a result, the union membership rate in the United States fell by more than half between 1978 and 2017, from 26 to 10.7%. Brown has long stood out as one of the few Democrats who refused to learn that lesson. The son of a physician father from Mansfield, Ohio, and a social activist mother from Mansfield, Gage, he never worked in a factory himself, instead he went straight into politics after studying Russian at Yale. But Brown was raised, he says, with a sense of justice. His mom crusaded for civil rights, his father never forced patients to pay more than they could afford, and so, as a young state representative in the mid-1970s, he would spend his Fridays at the local union halls, Steel 169 and UAW 549. I'd hang around for 2 or 3 hours in the morning or afternoon, and I would listen to workers coming in, Brown recalls. A lot of them were working at least 2, maybe 3 shifts. I knew their kids because I'd gone to the big public high school, and I'd only recently graduated. Right away I understood that they had more challenges than I did, as a doctor's kid. If they got in trouble, they didn't have the same safety net, the same privileges. These were Brown's neighbors and earliest constituents, and even as he left Mansfield to climb the political ladder, he kept their concerns front and center. For 18 years, he refused to enroll in a congressional health plan, saying he would not accept federally subsidized care until the American public could avail itself of the same option. In Congress, Brown went on to lead the bipartisan opposition to the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, crossing then-President Bill Clinton. More than 2 decades later, he helped torpedo the Trans-Pacific Partnership, defying Barack Obama. In between, Brown wrote a book called Myths of Free Trade. On election night 2016, he surprised his gloomy staffers by immediately offering to help Trump renegotiate NAFTA. Some of the story is familiar. The 2008 Wall Street crash, too big to fail, the long, sluggish recovery, the deep income inequality that only deepened in the process. Then Trump came along with his divisive America First rhetoric and performed better with union households than any Republican presidential nominee since Ronald Reagan, flipping just enough votes in the deindustrializing blue wall states of Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania to win the Electoral College. Out went corporatist, Hillary Clinton-style caution, in came bold, progressive resistance. Suddenly unions seemed cool again. One more item on the list of retro things young Americans are rediscovering, according to Mother Jones. In 2017, union membership actually increased for the first time in decades, and more than 3/4 of those new members were under the age of 35. At the same time, Pew Research found that 75% of 18 to 29-year-olds, including 55% of young Republicans, view unions favorably, by far the highest proportion of any age group. The reason, D. Taylor told me in Nevada, is simple self-interest. I have 2 younger daughters, 24 and 30, he said. When I talk to my daughters even a few years ago, they know the work I do, they'd go, oh dad, we're more into social justice. Not anymore. Now they see they can't get stable, well-paying jobs. So they go, okay, I don't know a lot about unions, but I know the system right now is not working. the ripple effects of this small but significant comeback have started to spread. Over the last year, teachers have gone on strike in Arizona, Colorado, Los Angeles, North Carolina, Oklahoma, and West Virginia. In November, Missouri voters overwhelmingly defeated a Republican right-to-work measure. And 2018 was a banner year for organizing and bargaining in newsrooms nationwide. Could the 2020 election be next? Brown, for one, is betting on it. If the senator decides to run, and his staff seems to assume he will, his larger campaign will probably look and sound a lot like his early visit to Nevada. Of course, Brown would hardly be the only populist on the trail. Bernie Sanders is back, and he will continue to excoriate the millionaires and billionaires. Elizabeth Warren, who passed on a presidential bid in 2016, is running as well, and she's still explaining how she would unrig the system. The rest of the Democratic field is sounding similar notes. But in Las Vegas, Brown demonstrated several ways he would distinguish himself. The first is a matter of perspective. Sanders, Warren, and their ilk tend to view the world through an anti-Wall Street lens. Brown sees everything from a pro-worker perspective. To the casual listener, Sanders and Warren can sound like they're bashing billionaires or bankers because they're billionaires or bankers, a message that might resonate in liberal enclaves like Vermont or Massachusetts but doesn't play as well in middle America. In contrast, Brown is always careful to remind voters that the real problem isn't wealth, per se it's that workers are no longer sharing in the wealth they help create. It's there in the way he talks about his proposals, as he did during a Views and Brews event with local Democrats at Lovelady Brewing in Henderson, a Vegas suburb. As a veteran senator, Brown has no shortage of legislative ideas, most of which are designed to strengthen key labor standards to reflect an economy that increasingly relies on alternative work arrangements, temps, subcontractors, freelancers, and such. Expand collective bargaining rights. Ensure that alternative workers get benefits too. Crack down on employers that force people to work off the clock, refuse to pay the minimum wage, deny overtime pay, steal tips or knowingly misclassify workers to avoid paying fair wages. The first bill basically says that if you pay a decent wage, provide decent benefits and you do your production in the United States, you get a lower tax rate, Brown explained in Henderson. But the other bill says when a big company that has executives making millions of dollars a year pays workers $8, $10, $12 an hour, and as a result those workers are eligible for Section 8 housing, the earned income tax credit, food stamps and Medicaid, that those companies pay a freeloader fee to reimburse taxpayers for subsidizing their workers. That's the debate we should be having. As I've done this Dignity of Work tour, I've heard from people like you who have pushed back on what we do, Brown said. And you're right, Democratic presidents never do enough. Sure, they put really good, progressive, pro-labor folks in the Department of Labor. But you've got to think about the whole government. You've got to think of people at the Department of Homeland Security, the Department of the Interior, the Department of Agriculture, right? Blanco shouted. They don't have to be union activists, Brown continued. They could be. But they need to be people who think about workers. Whenever Homeland Security makes a decision, whenever the Department of Agriculture makes a decision, they think, what does this mean to workers? I want to see us engage in trade talks, bilaterally or multilaterally, to lift all workers, Brown concluded, saying that his story illuminates how we need to look at the world around us, even though it didn't have anything to do with the question he was asked. Yet in the end, this kind of message discipline could prove to be a plus, particularly in a crowded field competing for attention from a distractible media and a distracted electorate. Brown knows his brand, and he knows how to market it. Identity and ideology would likely be bigger hurdles. As a straight white male who will turn 68 the week of the 2020 election, Brown is not the sort of trailblazing candidate that many Democrats want to lead their diverse party. And though he would be one of two people in the primary who voted against the Iraq War, one of two people who voted against NAFTA, the only person who has a long-term F rating from the NRA and one of the few who've been pushing for marriage equality for 20 years, as he likes to say on the stump, Brown has refused to join colleagues, often those with less liberal records, in endorsing this cycle's biggest, boldest ideas: Medicare for all, the Green New Deal, a federal jobs guarantee, and on so on. I know the popular thing to say is, let's guarantee a job for everybody, Brown responded when asked in Henderson whether he would support a federal jobs guarantee. But I don't know how you do a guaranteed job. Brown explains his reticence in perfectly rational terms. Voters increasingly see that Trump lied when he made promises, he told me. I'm not judging other Democrats, but I don't want to make promises that I think are so hard to keep. The things I talk about, we can do. When it comes to identity, the assumption is that Brown would fall squarely on the side of the internal Democratic debate that says the party should focus on winning back white, Rust Belt Obama-Trump voters rather than turning out younger minority non-voters in Sun Belt states like Georgia and Arizona. But while Brown does like to pledge that he will beat Donald Trump in my state, where they know me best, he actually doesn't buy the notion that Democrats have to choose one path or the other as long as they emphasize labor itself, which transcends such divides. You'll never hear me say white working class voters, because I'm talking to voters of both genders, all races, all ages, and all incomes, he told me after the culinary workers event. One of the great things about a trade union is its ability, more often than not, to look beyond race and gender. It's about better wages and better benefits for everyone. That's why it's called the union movement. Brown looked around the room. And this union is about as good an example as you can get. I looked around too. There were some white faces in the crowd. But there were as many, if not more, Latino faces, black faces and Asian American faces. Local 226, which represents workers in casinos, hotels, bars and restaurants, has an especially diverse membership, 55% women, 54% Latino, 15% Asian, 10% black, and only 19% white. But it's not alone. While the popular image of a union worker is a white guy on a Midwestern manufacturing line, the reality is quite different. As of 2016, about two-thirds of union-covered workers age 18 to 64 were women and/or people of color, according to the Economic Policy Institute, and non-white workers in that category outnumbered white workers nearly 3-1. As for ideology, being a so-called labor Democrat could help with that too. In previous elections, Brown's counteroffers to liberals Medicare at 55, adding a public option to Obamacare, doubling the earned income tax credit, would have been tarred as socialism by conservatives and considered unpalatable among moderates. Now, in a 2020 field that's flirting with actual democratic socialism, Brown's, still very progressive, plans seem more pragmatic. At the same time, his career-long commitment to labor, the cornerstone of modern leftism in America, could serve to persuade wary progressives that he's not some sort of purple state triangulator. How Brown will fare in a national campaign, though, remains to be seen. On TV, he can come across as somewhat dour and disheveled. A recent Quinnipiac poll showed that 77% of Democrats don't know enough about him to form an opinion, positive or negative. Yet in person, Brown is a surprisingly spry and sunny retail politician, peppering both voters and reporters with personal questions he always asks for, and usually remembers, both first and last names, and staying long after events to sign posters and pose for selfies. Can Brown compete in an age when Trumpian brashness and bombast have increasingly become the norm? At the brew pub in Henderson, Connie Schultz started with a story about how her husband once swayed a skeptic. My dad was a utility worker for 36 years, for Utility Workers of America, Local 270, she said. I wanted him to meet this man I was going to marry. And he said, no, I don't have to do that. I knew what was going on. He thought a member of Congress, 'cause Sherrod was already a member of the House, was going to think he was too good for him. Worse, My dad thought Sherrod was too good for him. A few weeks before the wedding, Schultz's father finally agreed to lunch. My dad had taken a buyout recently from the plant in Ashtabula, Ohio, on the shore of Lake Erie, Schultz continued. So one of the first things I hear Sherrod say to him was, "So Chuck, I hear you took the buyout." And Dad says, "Yeah." And Sherrod goes, "How's your pension? How are the union benefits? Are you still active in the union?" An hour and a half later, my dad's girlfriend and I had gotten to know each other very well. The crowd laughed. That whole time, Schultz explained, Sherrod and my dad were talking about what it meant to be a union member. I learned more about my dad's job that day than he had ever told me. And at the end, we were walking out to the car, and my dad grabbed my sleeve and he said, "Hey, he's us in a tie."